Hello everybody, this is Jörg once again from YouTube channel Jörgler66, and today I will do another reading from the book Rulers of Evil, as we have done already some of the other chapters up until the 11th. And as I told you when I left off at the end of chapter 11, the next one will be a very, very interesting and surely not to miss chapter of this book. It is called Lorenzo Ricci's War. And when you know a little bit about the founding of the United States of America, and excuse me, I haven't even read it yet, this chapter, I am very sure that this will lead up to explain to you in plain words what the American Revolution was really about, how the Jesuits were involved from much earlier than 1776 to make sure that when they push their agenda for a United States of America nation and the independence of that nation from at that time Protestant England, to tear it apart like in like it was described in the book that Walt Stickel has called his website after, Grand Design Exposed. So before I will even start reading Rulers of Evil, I will read to you a little excerpt from the book Grand Design Exposed. So the part I'm going to read to you comes from the pages 326 through 329 from the book Grand Design Exposed from John Daniels. And it reads as follows. Quote, upon returning to Maryland after his trip to Canada, Charles Carroll was chagrined to find that the Tory faction, or the Loyalists, had succeeded in having a resolution adopted that declared, quote, a reunion with Great Britain on constitutional principles would most effectually secure the rights and liberties and increase the strength and promote the happiness of the whole empire, unquote. With this empire, of course, we are speaking about the British Empire at that time. Further, the resolution prohibited the Maryland delegates to the Continental Congress favoring any movement for independence. Charles Carroll, and with others who shared his view, set in motion the process to recall the instructions given to the delegates while he was away and reversed them, which in essence was Maryland's Declaration of Independence. This was the work of Charles Carroll, and as a reward he was immediately elected a delegate from Maryland to the Continental Congress. End quote. So this will give you a little bit more insight when I now start reading chapter 12 of Rulers of Evil, called Lorenzo Ricci's War. And once again, before you forget that, Lorenzo Ricci was at that time the Superior General of the Society of Jesus. He was that in the time that the Jesuits actually were forbidden by a papal bull in 1773, but that's something else we come to a little bit later. Okay, I'm going to start reading now in chapter 12. Lorenzo Ricci's strategy of dividing the British imperial system can be discerned in events occurring as early as 1752. In that year, Catholic interests in America were rather poorly managed by the Congregation for the Propaganda at Rome, depending upon a tangle of ambassadors, or nuncios, and intermediaries in Madrid, Paris, London, and Brussels. The Jesuit mission was to consolidate these often adversarial parts into a dynamic and independent whole governed directly from the mind of the Black Papacy. Now, in 1752, the Society of Jesus was brilliantly powerful and had been so for nearly a century. Most statesmen, a fine Jesuit historian has written, reckoned that the society was a major force in politics, an international great power acting primarily for its own interests. Unquote. Lorenzo Ricci had been spiritual father of this great power for nearly a year. Although that little assured him of unanimous election as superior general upon the demise of General Luigi Centurioni, it presently endowed him with diplomatic oversight embracing the whole world. Ricci's particular geographic interests included France and its possessions in New France, the whole Mississippi Valley from Canada and the Great Lakes down to the Gulf of Mexico, and England and its colonies in New England, all the lands to the south of French Canada and north of Spanish Florida stretching from the Atlantic to the Pacific coast. Both empires were to a certain extent Jesuit-driven. Great Britain was run by the Catholic loathing system of Freemasonry, whose highest adepts obeyed the revered, quote-unquote, unknown superior, which you have learned already by reading this book, who this unknown superior was. France was run by Louis XV, who obeyed the same superior through his Jesuit confessor, Père de Sacy. De Sacy's good-natured ministry reduced the king's dinner on a strict fast diet from 8 courses to 5 and limited his wine consumption to 3 glasses per sitting. Now, Sun Tzu wrote, quote, "I demand the art of making enemies move as one wishes. Those who possess the admirable art know how to arrange their men and the army they command in such a way that they make the enemy come toward them whenever they judge it appropriate. They know how to make generous gifts when appropriate, even to those they wish to conquer." Now, I'm going to interrupt right here with this sentence. They know how to make generous gifts when appropriate, even to those they wish to conquer. This reminds me of the gift given to the United States of America by the French, called the Statue of Liberty, that you see outside of New York Harbor. And we all know that that Statue of Liberty is the same as that Liberty that is sitting on the dome of Capitol Hill in Washington. But I think this is quite interesting to read Sun Tzu right here, to say, quote, "They know how to make generous gifts when appropriate, even to those they wish to conquer," unquote. Something to think about, right? Okay, Sun Tzu goes on to say, "They give to the enemy and the enemy receives. They abandon things to him and he comes to take them. They are ready for anything. They take advantage of any circumstance. They do not fully trust those whom they employ, but choose others to be their overseers. They do not count on their own strength alone, but use other means which they believe can be useful to them. They consider the men against whom they must fight to be stones or pieces of wood, which they have been asked to roll down a slope. You, therefore, who are commanding an army, must act in such a way that the enemy is in your hands like a round stone that you have caused to roll down a mountain 1,000 paces high. Thus it will be recognized that you have power and authority, and that you are truly worthy of the position you occupy." Unquote from Sun Tzu. Lorenzo Ricci transformed British and French colonial personnel into round stones by creating a crisis between their conflicting imperial claims to dominion in North America. In 1752, his spiritual fatherhood directed French soldiers and their Indian allies to destroy the important British colonial trading center on the upper Great Miami River. Then followed the plundering, capture, or killing, not murdering, but papally absolved extirpating of every English-speaking trader in the upper Ohio Valley that the French and Indians could locate. although these lands were legally British, dating from a grant to Virginia by King James I in 1609, the important Virginia families failed to emphasize that the misfortunes of explorer inhabitants in such remote and undeveloped wilderness. But when, toward the end of 1752, the Virginia government granted an additional 1,500,000 acres of Ohio Valley land, empathies burst into bloom. Suddenly, the Virginians had something to lose, and it was being lost to a band of Roman Catholics and their Indian converts. In 1753, French engineers constructed a chain of forts connecting Lake Erie with the Ohio River. The governor of Virginia dispatched a small militia to confront these Catholic trespassers. Leading the militia was a recent initiate into the Fredericksburg Masonic Lodge, 21-year-old Major George Washington. Washington warned the garrison at Fort Leboeuf that it was illegally occupying Virginia real estate, quote, so notoriously known to be the property of the Crown of Great Britain, unquote. He read aloud the governor's demand that they depart. The French ignored him, and he returned home. Despite a clear indication that the French intended not to concede to the governor's demands, Virginia encouraged the Ohio Company to build a palisaded fort at the fork where the Allegheny and Monongahela rivers join to create the Ohio River, where Pittsburgh now stands. The government pledged Virginian troops to support the venture. Construction began in the spring of 1754. Almost immediately, French and Indians descended upon the tiny crew of woodcutters and carpenters and overwhelmed them. By the time Washington, now a lieutenant colonel, could reach the scene, he was forced by Catholic firepower to fall back to Fort Necessity. Here Washington surrendered on July 4th. Interesting day. It was his clash between British and French armies that precipitated what was called by contemporary writers, quote-unquote, the Maritime War, or Great War, or Great War for the Empire, or 7 Years' War, or French and Indian Wars. It could more appropriately be called Lorenzo Ricci's War. As these rounded stones began rolling, Moore succumbed to Ricci's gentle touch. The colony most affected by the fighting was Meek, Pennsylvania, the colony originally settled by adherents of the renowned Quaker leader William Penn. Penn had been dead a whole generation, and ownership of his colony had developed upon a British corporation which included some of Penn's descendants and was known austerely as the Proprietors. The proprietors wanted wars in Pennsylvania to be fought by Pennsylvanians. The Quakers, who controlled the assembly, abhorred the notion of Pennsylvanians bearing arms. When the assembly voted to raise a war chest, the Quakers stepped down and out of power. First, however, they appointed their most celebrated member, Dr. Benjamin Franklin, official printer of Pennsylvania's paper currency, to sail to London and represent them against the proprietors. Dr. Franklin, who happened to be Grand Master of Pennsylvania Freemasonry, arrived in London to find that King George II, having made peace with France as recently as 1748, favored the proprietors. The king's attitude was, quote, let Americans fight Americans, unquote. Franklin explained that Virginia's undisciplined militiamen and the pacifists of Pennsylvania were no match for seasoned French regulars and savage Indian braves. France was jeopardizing British imperial interests. The king acquiesced to Franklin's reasoning and ordered General Edward Braddock to take a small army to clear the forks of the Ohio of the French trespassers. He also sent Admiral Edward Boscawen's fleet to the Gulf of St. Lawrence to prevent the arrival of more French reinforcements in Canada. All this was in perfect obedience to Lorenzo Ricci's strategy of establishing a British military presence in America. The Crown ultimately would require the Americans to pay for this presence, which would expose the colonists to taxation from afar, which they could readily be fomented to resist. The resistance would be met with harassment and would incite rebellion and ultimately division. The philosophical similarities between Quakers and Loyolan Gnosticism should not escape our notice. Quote-unquote Quaker, the term, was first used by an English judge in 1650 to ridicule how the leader of that denomination, George Fox, admonished him to, quote, tremble at the word of the Lord, unquote. Fox summoned all who sought spiritual truth and peace to come out of the churches and seek an intimate, quote, personal relationship with Christ, unquote. Jesus of the Quakers spoke through inner illumination, a light available to all, having nothing to do with outward forms of ceremony, ritual, or creed. To the Quaker, every person was a walking church. Every heart was God's altar and shrine. There was no need, therefore, to attend, quote, steeple houses, unquote, or pay taxes to support a state church clergy, or doff a hat to king or commoner, or fight wars, or distinguish between sex or social class. Such doctrine, of course, was highly offensive to the Church of England, and so the Quakers were mercilessly persecuted as treasonous criminals. They found a haven across the Atlantic in the colony conveniently granted by King Charles II to William Penn, one of the more outspoken English Quakers. Charles granted the land to settle a debt the Crown owned Penn's deceased father, Admiral Sir William Penn. Knowledgeable contemporaries publicly charged the younger Penn with being, quote, a Jesuit in disguise, unquote. Actually, all Catholic clergy in England were to a certain extent, quote unquote, in disguise, thanks to a law prohibiting Roman Catholicism of wearing clerical garb. Promulgated with the intent of handicapping popery, the law might as well have been written by Jesuits, as its effect reduced the Jesuit profile to nothing, the level preferred by covert militias. 18th century London was teeming with disguised Jesuit missioners trained at places like St. Omer's in moral theology, casuistry, equivocation, and mental reservation, as well as espionage, cloak and dagger diplomacy, guerrilla tactics, and the manipulation of public opinion. William Penn's higher education began at Cardinal Wolsey's endowment for the furtherance of papal supremacy, Christ Church College at Oxford. Before completing Oxford, Penn was sent by his father to the small University of Somer, France. Penn left Somer by an accomplished propagandist less interested in achieving specific biblical objectives. Between brackets, much reading is an oppression of the mind, he would later advise his children. Brackets closed. Then in establishing illuminated social justice through reason and natural understanding. His most influential work, the pamphlet, quote, No Cross, No Crown, unquote, published in 1669, agitated for Quaker separatism. Charles II readily accommodated Penn's agitations by launching the Great Persecution of 1682, which created enormous migrations of diehard Protestants and Catholics alike to the American colonies. If Penn was not the Jesuit he was believed to be, he was at least a rather superior Jesuit product. Another in a long train of princes, designated proprietor in Penn's case, deferring to the Quakers' dislike for titles of nobility, well trained to populate, administer, and defend their land grants in obedience to the will of the grantor. So what gift is that when you have to do something for it, right? Penn's example, and Franklin's after him, inspired Franklin's esteemed Masonic brother Jean-François Arouet, better known as Voltaire, a founder of the Enlightenment, to memorialize Quakers as the noblest kind of born-again European. Yet well-informed Englishmen saw neither Quaker nor regeneration in Penn's curiously compromising friendship with James II, who succeeded Charles II in 1685. What possible league could a Quaker have with a king? Worse, a king converted to Roman Catholicism by Jesuits? Certainly no true Quaker could have written Penn's charter from the city of Philadelphia, which amounted to his gift of that estate to the Church of England. In the charter's preamble, Penn states, quote, "I have, by virtue of the King's letters patent, under the great seal of England, erected the said town into a borough, and do by these presents erect the said town and borough into a city." Unquote. The name city in every case signifies the location of a bishop's see, S-E-E, the seat of his authority, from the Latin sedes, and the territory under his supervision. No place in England was called a city unless governed by a bishop, as in the see of or city of Canterbury, see or city of York, see or city of London, of Bath and Wells, of Bristol, of Salisbury, etc. With the Philadelphia Charter, Penn erected for the persecuting Church of England a nearly invisible mechanism for recycling the very victims of its persecutions. Indeed, Penn's last will and testament, which became effective with his death in England in 1718 at the age of 74, turned all Pennsylvania into the same mechanism with these words, quote, "The government of my province of Pennsylvania, and territories thereunto belonging, and all powers relating thereto, I give and devise to the most honorable the Earl of Oxford, and Earl Mortimer, and their heirs, upon trust, to dispose thereof to the Queen Anne, or to any other person, to the best advantage and profit they can." Unquote. With a stroke of Penn's quill, the children of the Quakers who had followed him out of the Church of England were literally given back. To become free of this bondage, the Quakers were obliged to align themselves with the Church of Rome, at least the Black Papacy. This alliance was facilitated by Benjamin Franklin, whose political career was built on defending the Quakers' interests against the propriety heirs, which were the Church of England. Against this common enemy, Franklin and the Quakers united, knowingly or unknowingly, with the designs of the Roman Church militant. While these stones rolled unstoppably toward their objective, Jesuit General Luigi Centurioni died. Early in May of 1758, the general congregation arrived at Rome to choose his successor. On the last day of the month, the congregation unanimously elected Lorenzo Ricci, the society's spiritual father and secretary, as its 18th black pope. Ricci, a professor in philosophy, theology, and the classics at the Roman College, was known for his patient, placid nature, his even temper. He inherited an organization in remarkably good shape. The Latin American missions were flourishing. A mission had just been established in Poland. Everywhere the schools and colleges were prospering. In the natural sciences, Jesuits were counted among the world's leading authorities. Their presence an economic and secular government had never been more imposing. As the papal nuncio to Vienna stated in a letter to his superior at the Vatican, quote, "The Jesuits have the upper hand over everything, even the most prominent ministers of state, and domineer over them if they do not carry out their will." Unquote. But the society's legendary power could hinder Catholic activity in the Protestant missions. To defeat Great Britain without a battle, Lorenzo Ricci required the abilities and resources of an important Maryland family, the Carrolls. The three Carroll sons, Daniel, John, and their first cousin Charles, all now in their 20s, had been trained in Jesuit warfare at St. Omer's, and there was a full stop. And if you want to know anything more about this training, then I really advise you to follow the reading that Tom Frest does at this moment. He is up to 13 parts already that he reads of the book Global Vatican that was written by Francis Rooney, and he was the nuncio or ambassador to the Holy See for the United States of America between the years 2005 and 2008. And in this book, Global Vatican, as Tom reads it now on Inquisition Update on First Amendment Radio, you can follow that live every morning at, I think it's 8 o'clock or something, you can look that up if you in that region are living and want to check that for live broadcast, or otherwise you go to the YouTube channel of First Amendment Radio, where all the readings are uploaded as video, or you wait a little bit and go to my second channel, Jogless War on Disinfo, where I also upload all these videos with a delay in respect to Nicholas Arthur's work, that his work can be seen first, of course. So when you go and study that book a little bit, The Global Vatican, and follow the reading of Tom Frest, where I am now listening to, I think the last one I was listening to was part 10 or something, he also goes into the Carrolls, and he goes into a history that is even not mentioned here, as far as I know, in the book of Rulers of Evil, that these Carrolls, who were eminent in the founding of the United States of America in 1776, actually came from a family of mercenaries for the Pope. They made a bunch of money as soldiers for the Pope. That's how they got their wealth. And we did already other broadcasts on Hour of the Truth and Nothing But the Truth and other broadcasts with the Jesuit connection to 1776 on Block Talk when we were with Wall together 2 years ago, where we mentioned all these riches that they had and how the Carrolls even financed the Revolutionary War. But that's also something that we go deeper into the reading here. But if you want to know a little bit more about St. Omer's, where Charles and Daniel and John were Jesuit educated, that is in I think in France right now, or it's here in Flanders, I don't know, I haven't looked that up, but it's all in, you know, the place where today is Belgium and France. There were a lot of Jesuit schools at that time, and they educated the three Carrolls, Daniel, John, and their cousin Charles. And if you want to go a little bit deeper into that, then really advise you the reading of Francis Rooney's Global Vatican, where he, and he's a Catholic, probably even a Jesuit educated one, explicitly explains the role of the Carrolls that is so hidden from your, let's call it, official history, from the history you are not supposed to know. The history you are taught is what you are supposed to know, and the history that you are not supposed to know is the one that I am reading here, and the one that Tom has been reading with a lot of books over the years on First Amendment Radio, on the Inquisition Update, and is reading right now with Global Vatican. So there you see how it all intertwines, right? Okay, I just wanted to give you that advice to go there and you know, it's not only listening to this book and reading this book, you also have to do a little bit of your own study. So I'm going to give you that advice to go in that direction. And then you will certainly have a much better picture of the whole history that I'm reading here and that Tom is reading over there when you put these two or even other information that you gather yourself together. You will have a much better view on the reality. So the three Carroll sons, Daniel, John, and their first cousin Charles, all now in their 20s, had been trained in Jesuit warfare at St. Omer's. John was teaching there. Charles was studying law at the Jesuit College Louis le Grand in Paris, about to undertake further studies in London's Inner Temple. Daniel, of Daniel's activities between 1753 and 1781, very little is known. What is well known is that the Carroll's lads were among the wealthiest Americans alive. The mother of Daniel and John, Eleanor Darnell, claimed direct descendant from the Calverts, the owning family of original Maryland. She had come into possession of much of the land that Daniel would transfer to the District of Columbia. Charles Carroll stood to inherit America's largest private estate. Later, John Adams would label him America's richest citizen. Lorenzo Ricci could not win his war without the overt participation of the Carrolls. But New England was virulently Protestant. What Protestant leader would stoop to cooperate with devout Roman Catholics schooled in trickery by the all-powerful Jesuits? Would uniting with Jesuits not be laying America's future at the feet of the Bishop of Rome? In this consensus, Ritchie was able to discern a valuable negative weapon. If the stones of envy and hatred were given a gentle nudge, their own weight and momentum could spectacularly blast the Society of Jesus to smithereens. With the Society out of the way, Roman Catholicism would hang in the wind, defenseless. To a Protestant's perception, the Church would no longer be a forceful contender for military power. Sun Tzu advised a ruse known in the lingo of modern covert professionals as, quote, blown cover as cover, unquote. There will be times when you will lower yourself and others, when you pretend to be afraid. Sometimes you will feign weakness, so that your enemies opening the door to presumption and pride and come to attack you unwisely, give out false information about the state you are in. The enemy, believing it to be true, will act in consequence toward his generals and all the officers presently at his service. So even not mentioned, I think this was a quote from Sun Tzu. Yes, sudden misfortune would bless the society. Weakness and persecution would be transformed into magnificent new capital for building sympathetic relationships with other weak and persecuted people, such as the British colonists were destined soon to become. Without detailing his strategy, for Sun Tzu says, quote, you will act in such a way that those who are inferior to you can never guess your intentions, unquote. Lorenzo Ricci affirmed to the general congregation that storm clouds were gathering on the horizon. The congregation summarily gave its understanding in obedience to the, quote, hidden design of, quote-unquote, hidden design of their new superior general, who occupied, after all, the place of Jesus. It issued a call for esprit to the brotherhood at large. Quote, if God permitting it because of his hidden designs which we could do nothing else but adore, we are to become the butt of adversity. The Lord will not abandon those who remain attached and united to him. And as long as the society is able to go to him with an open soul and a sincere heart, no other source of strength will be necessary for it. Unquote. The Prime Minister of Portugal, Sebastian the Marquis de Pombal, had been conducting what the New Catholic Encyclopedia calls, quote, a long campaign of calumnies false rumors, distorted manipulation of incidents, all intent on undermining the Jesuits' reputation by ascribing to them nefarious doctrines, purposes and practices." Unquote. Among Pombal's allegations were that the Jesuits had incited revolts in Paraguay, a Portuguese colony, and had traded illegally, had even conspired to murder the king. Again, I'm going to take a little pause here because Paraguay is mentioned at that time. Among Pombal's allegations were that the Jesuits had incited revolts in Paraguay. And when you want to know anything more about that, then just go to a search engine on the internet, Google or whatever, and type in the Paraguay reductions or Jesuit reductions, and you will see how they already at that time invented in Paraguay and enforced at that time in Paraguay what was later called communism. I'm going to continue reading now. Pombal supported his claim with numerous anti-Jesuit tracts and inflammatory pastoral letters, which he submitted to Parliament. In the Society's defense, a group of bishops showered Pope Clement XIII with letters commending the Jesuits for their invaluable work. Clement, known by Jesuit historians as a quote-unquote a Jesuited Pope, hastened to send copies of these endorsements to Lorenzo Ricci for publication under the title Catholic Ecclesiastical Judgment for the Present Status of the Society of Jesus. Publication of these endorsements would show the world that the Society enjoyed the solid support of the Roman hierarchy. Significantly, Ricci declined to publish them. On January 19, 1759, the Marquis de Pombal procured a royal decree expelling the Jesuits from Portugal and its overseas colonies. More than 1,000 Jesuit fathers were crammed into ships and dumped on the shores of the Papal States, then an area in central Italy only slightly more spacious than Switzerland. Those 250 fathers were cast into dungeons, many perishing from maltreatment. The Portuguese crown seized all the society's houses, churches and colleges as well. Stones were then nudged in France. The superior of a Jesuit mission in the Caribbean, Père Lavalette, had obtained commercial credit to finance his mission in Martinique. When it happened that he could no longer pay his debt, a trading firm in Marseille alleged damages against him of more than 2 million francs. Lavalette asked Lorenzo Ricci for help. Ricci turned him down. The firm sued the society in the French court and won. Ricci then appealed the case to the Parliament in Paris, which was more of a supreme court than a legislative body. His lawyers argued that the society could not be held liable for personal debts of its members due to a prohibition laid down by Saint Ignatius himself in the constitutions against any members doing business with a principal or partner. Although this claim was easily dismissible as a flimsy legal fiction, the court demanded evidence to support it. This required Lorenzo Ricci to produce the constitutions, which had never before been publicly revealed. When the volumes were brought to court and examined, the government attorney had a field day. A lawyer from Brittany named La Châtelet charged the constitutions was a handbook of, quote, every known form of heresy, idolatry and superstition, which provides tutelage in suicide, legicide, blasphemy and every kind of impurity, usury, sorcery, murder, cruelty, hatred, vendetta, insurrection and treason, unquote. As the Lavalette case unfolded, during 1759 and 1760, Benjamin Franklin's beloved Voltaire slammed the Jesuits in two satirical plays mounted on the Parisian stage. educated in the humanities and theatrical arts by Jesuits at the Collège Louis le Grand, Voltaire served the society and the Catholic Church with distinction by becoming their chief critic and debunker, much in the way Will Rogers served Franklin Roosevelt's administration by lampooning New Deal politicians, or in the way Keystone Cops tickled an America being transformed into a police state. Audiences at Candid howled at Jesuit buffoons strutting about self-importantly drilling their Paraguayan Indian troops. In the account of sickness, confession, death and apparition of the Jesuit Berthier, the editor of a Jesuit literary review who dies of sheer boredom challenges the notion that the society is even worthy of existence. With his predecessor Blaise Pascal, whose provincial letters had alerted earlier generations to the egomania of high Jesuitry, Voltaire provided a spirit of ridicule which gave Jesuit bashing the feel of good sport. Lorenzo Ricci's handling of the Lavalette case resulted in a resolution passed by the Parliament on August 6, 1762, condemning the Jesuits as, quote, endangering the Christian faith, disturbing the peace of the Church, and in general building up far less than they destroy, unquote. The resolution continued, quote, the Society of Jesus by its very nature is inadmissible in any properly ordered state as contrary but to natural law, attacking all temporal and spiritual authority, and tending to introduce into church and state, under the specious veil of religious institute, not an order truly aspiring towards evangelical perfection, but rather a political organization whose essence consists in a continual activity by all sorts of ways, direct and indirect, secret and public, to gain absolute independence and the usurpation of all authority. They outrage the law of nature, and as enemies of the laws of France should be irrevocably expelled. Unquote. Louis XV's being an absolute monarch, parliamentary resolutions were worthless without his signature. Louis being obedient to his Jesuits, it was highly unlikely that he would ever sign a resolution condemning the Jesuits. Yet sign it he did. And why he did has remained a point of debate. Some say his mistress, Madame de Pompadour, probably a name you've heard before, craved vengeance against court Jesuits for implacably denying her a mass. Others say the king needed Parliament's favor to bail him out of debt. I submit that Louis signed because Lorenzo Ricci wanted him to. When the resolution became law, Ricci released the French Jesuits from their vows. The society as an institution ceased to exist on French soil. Louis consented to allow the Jesuits to remain in France, but as quote-unquote regular clergy. Others went to exile. Père Lavalette, whose financial problems had brought on the debacle, was exiled by Ricci to live the rest of his life as a private citizen in England. When the war that had begun in the Ohio Valley reached Martinique, the English occupied that tiny island and took over the Jesuit plantations, selling them, slaves and all, for more than enough money to have paid off Lavalette's debts. In the midst of their decomposing glory, the Jesuits received from Clement XIII an awesome gift, designed to make welcome the most humiliating of circumstances. This was the Mass and Office of the Sacred Heart, with its icon of a realistically bloody heart plucked from Christ's ribcage and ignited by an eternal flame. So, I will stop reading here from chapter 11 of Rulers of Evil, Lorenzo Ricci's War, because we've come to almost 45 minutes, and because we will be uploading this also on Blog Talk, we are restrained to 45 minutes, so I keep that an account. I hope that you've had a wonderful time doing this reading of the first part of chapter 11, or chapter 12, sorry, chapter 12 of Rulers of Evil, and I will continue in the next session. Until then, I thank you very much for watching, for listening, and wish you all a nice day. God bless you, and bye-bye.